Okay, we are live. Finally, after some interesting technical challenges, but it's all good. Welcome, Joel, to another live. I know you're quite a live junkie now over the, the last few months. So tonight, welcome everybody that may be joining us either tonight while we're live or later on if you're watching the replay. So we are talking about the creative industries, neurodivergent people, and which industries they thrive in. And we're going to be interviewing Joel, you know, hearing a bit about his opinion and the areas that he feels, you know, are potentially areas he'd like to go into, areas of people that he would like to work with, as well as areas that people are already excelling in when it comes to neurodiversity. So Joel, do us a favor, give us a 1 minute intro. Who is Joel and what is Joel all about?
Well, I'm still trying to find that out myself, but that's what life is, Mac, finding out about yourself and others.
And absolutely.
Until well, the game is up, so to speak. But I have been doing music for most of my life. I can't say career because you can't really have a career. Well, unless you're in Hollywood, you can't really have a career in the arts. If you're a kid, not in Hollywood, if you know what I mean.
Well, you can always try Elstree Studios, I guess.
You can always try that, but then you get rebuffed, I suppose, by the owners or the council or something. But even then, it's difficult to get in. But yes, I started off playing drums at the age of formal lessons, at the age of 5. And before that, at the age of 2, when I greatly annoyed people by banging on the table.
Were you one of those who would sit at the end of the table and beat a tune away with your fingers?
Yes.
I know several people like that, and it only annoys me because I can't put a beat together. So when I hear people who can just use their fingers to put a beat together, and I sit there and I'm like, you know, even a music instrument, I destroy the ambience, as I say. You know, talking about, you know, the areas that neurodiverse people really thrive in, you know, what, from your opinion and also from your research, what have you found to be the areas that neurodiverse people really thrive in?
Great question, Mac. And the areas that I would assume, and I use the word assume loosely because it's living proof almost, is from technology to music and acting and the creatives and the techno industries, not the genre, the no, that was kind of the music industry still, but anything which requires a brain to think differently on purpose, even though they're not allowed to think differently when you're in a job of any description, you have to follow rules. And as autistic people, we don't like that. And that's something that, rock and roll and music have in common with our autistic people. They don't like to follow the rules, essentially.
And I know when you talk about the rules, you know, what my perception is, can you give us a bit more of a background into what that looks like when you say the rules? Because you know, as an example, with a streaming situation that we have tonight, if we don't follow the rules, we don't go live. So, you know, and there have to be certain guidelines and rules in order for things to succeed and work. So what do you mean by not following the rules?
I think I mean, it, people saying effectively it's their way or no way. So if a boss tells you what to do, if your brain works in a certain way, then you will follow what you're meant to do there to get the task done, because you don't know any better. But if you are creative in any form of the word, you like to experiment.
And okay, what does that look like?
Well, it's like when I used to do videography, Mac. Sadly, don't get any callbacks right now because the industry is so saturated. But I'm given a blank canvas. There is a reason why I don't show the raw footage to anyone before they see the finished product. And which is why most people who do that for a living don't do it. It's because they don't want to ruin the charm of the entire finished product, and people start to nitpick if they see camera wonkies and out of focus, even though they have no idea how to do it themselves. They'd like to tell you how to do it, even though they have no way of knowing how to do it themselves.
So, go for it.
And I've lost the screen. If you leave someone to their own devices, you often will get a far better product if you let someone just express themselves. If I had a staff under me, I would not give a rat's backside how the task is done, as long as it gets done by the deadline. Obviously, deadlines are dead set, so we get things done by in lots of time, don't take forever. But as long as the thing works and the deadline's met, you could do it standing in your head if I can. You can do it sitting on the toilet. I don't really mind where you are when you do it, as long as it gets done.
So, but that, I think that comes down to a lot of the time comes down to, how people are instructed, as it were.
Yeah.
So, and I find that from all organizations, that there are a lot of organizations where people, depending on the person in charge, just give me a second. I just realized we've got a message from somebody saying that they would like to jump on and they have no idea how to find this. So give us a second.
Fantastic. I think that most of my side, most of the people that were attending my event earlier, about 20 minutes before this started.
There we go. So all done. When it comes to those people that give the instruction, unfortunately, we have what we call control freaks. And, a lot of people, especially business owners, especially when they're first starting out and they've got some experience in a specific industry, that being able to trust somebody else to get the job done is a big challenge. Because more often than not, they want to be able to see how the process is happening. They want to get involved. And it's that being able to delegate without actually getting involved in the process at the same time. Now, when we talk about creatives and we talk about, the neurodiverse creatives, talk to me about industries that you know where you've seen, evidence of neurodiverse people thriving and doing really well. So I know you mentioned a few of those earlier, but give us one and let's go a little bit deeper into that, if that's okay.
Well, the most obvious one has just come out, Mac, and expressed and told the world about his Asperger's. I mean, you can't get more successful. I mean, you can try, but you can't get much more successful than the richest man on the planet
Well, yeah, I guess it depends if you're looking at financial reward being a full proof of success.
Successful. I mean, he noticed his gaps in the market. He started PayPal. He then sold it and then started Tesla, or started the Tesla as well at the same time. And now he's buying Twitter. He notices things that most people don't notice. And when people don't notice things, they tend to miss the boat and, in some people's cases, the point as well.
So, so we're talking about Mr. Musk over there, and who knows, maybe one day he'll give you a call and say, "Hey, Joel, let me check out this RockstarX project of yours."
That'd be nice.
Of course, it would be nice. But in the meantime, with the number of people out there and the opportunities that people have within different creative industries, you've got the evidence of Elon Musk as an example. But historically, people that aren't neurodiverse, as it were, as you've mentioned in the past, don't necessarily come out and tell people that they are. Why is that?
One word: society.
Okay. Do you want to expand?
You see, society wants us to keep on, I'm using the prison term here, straight and narrow. According to them, anything out of the ordinary, kind of like Harry Potter, is weird and freaky. Not weird and wonderful. Weird and who are you to tell me you know better? It's quite sad, really, the way that society's conditioned us. It's not new either. You can trace this back from the dawn of time. Some people say the Big Bang. I personally think it's not a Big Bang at all. Yes,
so I think we
Big Bang is on drum kit, but it's not the same.
We can very easily go off at a tangent, I guess, on that kind of history. But I understand the society side of things, and perception has been a tough one. And as you've said in the past, it's not just for neurodiverse; it's for everything. When we look at society's judgment on everything from politics to religion to sexual orientation to you name it, there's so much judgment out there. And it's amazing how the world is so caught up with judging everything else. But, looking at oneself should be where, the starting point of where all our focus should be and where we're at with regards to ourselves. But that's a whole different discussion. So tell me quickly, Joel, with regards to the creative industries, I know we've spoken about, music before. We've spoken about gaming. Which one of those would you think right now is kind of a amazing stomping ground for people with neurodiversity? Or that
I would really say Mac, the music industry, because with that, unless you've got a label behind you telling you what to do, they only do that for three albums anyway, and then they generally flop on the third one. That's how it goes. Then you're sold secondhand. AC/DC paints a very good picture of that with one of their songs. So music is an expression. No one can tell you how to express yourself. And if you're playing a particular music, or in your brother-in-law's case, I'm sure, headbanging to God only knows, then that's how you're expressing. You can express through acting, sure, but it's not. If it's music, acting needs verbal. Most of the things in the creative industries and indeed the tech tech side as well, needs verbal communication. And music doesn't need that, because music is, in its own way, verbal.
And, you know, music is such a powerful medium when it comes to communication, because, you know, we've seen people being able to communicate or put feeling into the communication that is music, whether that be, you know, on the drums or guitar or multitude of other instruments. But, you know, when you look at how amazing the medium of music is, and the impact that it has, you know, on people that have any one of the, you know, the labels for, you know, that put them on the neurodiverse spectrum, as it were, there are major opportunities out there for creative disruption, as far as I see it, when it comes to, you know, people like yourself that want to be able to really make a big difference, not just through music, because, I mean, you've got lots of different bands and things that you've spoken about that have an incredible impact on you, but also being able to help people express themselves in music, you know, in and through music. And you recently shared with me a video of your cousin who plays drums with the Autistics. You know, if somebody was to meet him, as it were, say in a cafeteria having lunch, you know, their experience would be so different to meeting him at a live stage where he's behind the drum kit, because it's like, you know, it's that whole judging a book by its cover situation. So, you know, in the perfect world, what kind of things would you like to see happen, and what kind of opportunities would you like to see happen for people that, on neuro, you know, on the neurodiverse spectrum, but want to get into music?
Well, to those of you who haven't joined yet, and that's most of you.
Also, remember, this is goes live onto three different platforms. Yeah. So this is so it's one of those platforms.
No, just yes. I don't know who, I don't know what the statistics are for platforms, but that's another story. And this is why I fail in math. But I think every single person on the planet has the choice to do what is right and what is easy. Unfortunately, people take the easy route every time. No one bothers to take the what is right route, because that normally involves work. And as humans, even though if you're running multi-million dollar companies, you don't want more work, which is quite strange, because if you don't want more work, why are you running companies, you utter hypocrites? And well, Universal Music have at this point, we have did a survey of findings of they asked employees in the creative industries about their approach to neurodiversity.
Yeah.
And 77% of them said adapting to be, I'm reading on the side, you'd be sorry about this, adapting to be more neurodiversity friendly is not a priority for their organization over the next 12 months, or they say are unsure if it is. 77% have said that. 75% do not have or unsure they have policies and procedures in place for neurodiversity. 82% of people of companies do not have an approach to neurodiversity that is separate to their approach to disability. And 17% know how many neuro individuals they have in the organization. I mean, that says it all, Matt. That is shocking. Absolutely shocking. statistics.
Yeah, that is pretty frightening. And the fact that people don't know, you know, the people in their organization that actually need the help is you know, if you think about those statistics that you just put out there, what percentage did you say of people in their organization?
17.
I mean, just
pathetic.
17% know, you know, are aware of the people in their organization and what help they need. But that shows you, when it comes to organizations in today's world, where, you know, some organizations have thrived and they do so well when it comes to getting to know their employees and the help and support that they need. And then there are other companies that are so far off. I mean, I was speaking to somebody the other day within the organization, and my assumption was large corporate, you know, they've got multiple branches around the world. They're incredibly well known. And then when I started talking about, you know, their individuals in the company and how they work with different departments, and it was very, you know, if there was an issue, they would find somebody who knew something about it, but there wasn't real, you know, support for employees. It was very much very thin on the ground when it came to anything that was there to build, you know, engagement with their employees or support their employees. And the fact that still happens in today's day and age is quite
disgusting.
Yeah. Yeah. But I wanted to run through a few things with you quickly, because I did some research and I was just looking at some of the famous people, you know, that history has basically shown as being neurodiverse as such. And, you know, the list is quite interesting, because there are a lot of scientists and mathematicians and actors, ironically. So, you know, the movie industry.
I don't think that's ironic.
No, but the part that's ironic is the fact that we're talking about, you know, the music industry, as it were. And, you know, when we look at all these other areas, I mean, some of the people that you would never have, like, you don't even associate with that. Like, you know, Albert Einstein, as an example, now is, you know, said that if they had the tools that they use today to assess people for neurodiversity, you know, whichever label they have, is something that he would have been on the autism spectrum very clearly.
Quite right. I mean, no, it's not normal. It's certainly not normal to have an IQ of his stature. I think it's safe to say that a great proportion of Mensa would be classed as autistic.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But the frightening thing is, this is somebody that you know, experienced similar things to yourself when it comes to schooling, and, you know, being told that no, you don't fit in, you need to move somewhere else, and, you know, all those challenges of having to go to multiple places and being told that, you know, you're not going to be able to do certain things, and then, you know, he goes and does a hell of a lot more. But, you know, some of the recent lists, which were quite interesting, are, you know, things like, well, they've got Vincent van Gogh, you know, actors, artists, you know, Steven Spielberg, which for me was quite interesting. Yeah. And, you know, who doesn't know a Steven Spielberg movie? I mean, it's just, you know, off the charts.
I think Tim Burton might be on that list as well.
Yeah, you've got Thomas Edison, the inventor. You've got Alexander Graham Bell. You've got Benjamin Franklin, Henry Ford. I mean, like, almost all the major things that we think about. Like, one of the things that I didn't know is Lionel Messi. Did you know he was on the spectrum?
It's rumored. It's not been conclusive yet. But it's a rumor that he is. I read that as well, and also the other rumors, Marty Balin from Jefferson Airplane.
Okay. So I'm just looking at a list of what has been confirmed, as it were.
Daryl Hannah's on there as well, I think.
There's so many people. I mean,
Mozart.
Mozart's on there. Charles Darwin. Charles Schultz, the cartoonist, which, you know, historical Bob Dylan. You know, there's so many incredible people that, you know, you just don't associate. But it makes sense when you, with hindsight, you know, you kind of look back and you go, ah, yeah, okay. And that's the part that I think the world needs to really have, you know, stronger organizations that help people that are neurodiverse because of the incredible history that we have of what people have done is, you know, when we looked at the fact that only 22% of people with autism are actually employed in any full-time job across the globe, that is just
shocking.
Like, it's mind-blowing. But then you think about the fact that, you know, the incredible talents, you know, that are not fostered and not used to go forward and develop into something that, you know, can create opportunities. And this is where I think a lot of opportunity or a lot of focus needs to happen. And what are your thoughts with regards to, you know, how right now in music can make a difference for people with, you know, any form of neurodiversity?
Well, music, Mac, can help with, we know that it's the universal language of the world, and in some ways, the peaceful universal language of the world. No, I'm not a hippie, but if someone plays music, anyone who is interested in music, even if you're not, you start tapping along, you start joining in. And it's a form where, especially in the neurodiverse world, they can communicate with the neurotypicals and express to them in any way how they're feeling. You've got chords like minor and major, happy and sad. See, primary human feelings.
So, you know, I'm just conscious of our time. We've got about 2.5-3 minutes left, and we've got few.
No, no, we've got about 10 minutes, 30 minutes left. What do you want, about 40 minutes normally? Yeah.
No, half an hour. Otherwise, we don't want to bore people to death, but we want to make sure that we get you know, people knowing about what some of the things that we're going to be talking about, and you know, when we look at the other. We you know, if people haven't already known about this, we are doing an 8-part mini series with Joel, and going through several different subjects. So today is about the creative industry and you know, where people with neurodiversity thrive. And next week we're talking about something that is close to Joel's heart, which is the, you know, why he created RockstarX. So I'm going to give him a bit of a hard time. He doesn't know this, but I'm going to give him a bit of a hard time on the next session, because we'll really want to dive deep into.
You do realize, you know, that you just told me that you're going to give me a hard time. So by telling me,
giving you a bit of warning,
telling me and saying he doesn't know that I'm giving him a hard time.
You just found out
that I do know, because I'm right here.
Well, you now have the heads up, Joel. So get ready for a tough time. But it's all about why he created RockstarX, you know, where he wants to see it go, you know, the history behind it. And by the end of it, I'm hoping that everybody will have a very clear picture of what RockstarX is all about, where it's going to go, and the people's lives that it's going to touch, because it hasn't even yet started to blossom. It's still in its infancy, and I can see in 10, 20 years from now, it's going to be a very powerful organization that is, please God, going to make a massive difference to a lot of people and help and be the igniter to making a huge difference within neurodiversity and showing the world what's possible.
Matt doesn't know either that if I'm explaining all that and I'm not clear, he's going to have to clear it up.
Ah, We'll see. No pressure. Thanks, Joel. And then, you know, session four, we're going into autism, why it's not an illness that needs to be cured. And that's going to be an interesting discussion. So if you know of anybody, you know, watching this or that you know of that is in any way associated with somebody who has autism, or somebody themselves that, you know, you yourself, if you have autism of, you know, anywhere on the spectrum of autism, you know, come and join the conversation. We want to have real conversation. We want to hear real questions from you and your experiences. And, you know, Joel's going to share, you know, his insights into the fact, you know, that he doesn't need to be cured because he is a special human being as he is. And, you know, we're going to go into that in a little bit deeper. Then we're going to look at neurodiversity in the world and different organizations and what parts they play. And if you've got an organization that, you know, supports neurodiversity in any way, shape or form, you know, come and jump in the audience, come and throw some questions in there. Tell us about what you do. I know Joel would love to connect with your other organizations that are helping with when it comes to neurodiversity in any shape or form. And then we're going to go into a bit more detail on what does RockstarX actually do. Now, a lot of that's going to come from the organizations that reach out and join us in this mission to be able to help people with the ability to, you know, gain access in the music world, but also within other industries like gaming, etc. Joel, you want to jump in there before I carry on?
I do. I just also want to throw these statistics in the UK. This is the UK games industry. So neurodivergent conditions of employees in the game industry in the United Kingdom in 2021. Mac, I hope you're sitting down for this because the statistics are awful. A condition affecting concentration, e.g. ADHD, can't speak tonight, I apologise. Only 10% of people work in the industry. 10% in the gaming industry. And the gaming industry is huge. It doesn't get any better from there, unfortunately. Learning difficulties, including dyslexia, 7%. Autism's 4%. Wow. A condition affecting coordination, e.g. dyspraxia, 2% people work in the industry.
So it'd be interesting to dive into that and what the reasons for that is.
I think the reason is completely clear. I mean,
so you know, I mean, as an example, you know, I'm very conscious of the fact that you know, as an example, if you have a fear of swimming and you apply to be a lifesaver, that might be a challenge. You know, it's finding out what the reasons are for those percentages. So it'd be interesting to do a bit more research before we attack those in the coming weeks.
Yeah.
And then we are going to talk about autism as unique as the person who has it. And that I think will be quite an interesting conversation because, you know, it's amazing how when people say, oh, you know, somebody has autism, and then it's like, you know, how wide is that statement? Because it's anyway, we'll go into that because I can go
probably,
down there.
The statement is probably as wide as they've made the spectrum. Quite frankly, it's getting ridiculous. The spectrum has got too out of hand that even anyone that is in any, even drunk people now are clapped together on the spectrum. I mean, it's gone almost as ridiculous as political correctness, to be fair.
Well, let's be careful of drawing that line in case LinkedIn throw us off. Yeah, I mean, that's going to be a hectic or a really interesting conversation because I've having family members that are on the spectrum for many different things, but also friends and people that I know of in different organizations. We've had some pretty heated discussions around this, and it's really intriguing when you really dig deep into this, because for a parent with somebody that's just been labeled as autistic, I mean, that really doesn't really give them any guidance whatsoever.
No, it basically a label now says your child has got this condition and therefore I dub thee insane. What?
Yeah. So that's going to be an interesting discussion. And then the last one is RockstarX bridge the gap between NTs and NDs. Now, can you explain that to people that if they read that, don't have a clue what that means?
Well, that's
you're using acronym.
I mean, NDs are neurodiverse. I mean, I would have thought that after all these conversations where I put the full word in there, people
would but the audience, not everybody would have seen this.
People would have picked it up. But NTs are neurotypicals, which are like Mac.
Well, actually, according to the neurodiverse labels, I have dyslexia, so I'm in there, you know. I have a label, so what? Grammarly is a massive help.
And if you'd like to watch my video on my channel as well on YouTube with Achieving the Impossible with Autism, I do mention that I've got more labels than the fucking supermarket.
Excuse your language there. We're live on a family channel, YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn. You just heard a beep over there. It wasn't what he said. Do not rewind for confirmation. moving along swiftly. Over the next couple of weeks, the next 6 weeks, we are going to be having some interesting conversations there. These sessions, the first two, have been ad hoc because Joel is getting used to the whole new LinkedIn Live process. But the next six, we will be scheduling those so that there'll be a LinkedIn event that you can go to. Apologies to those people that went onto the LinkedIn link, an event that Joel created earlier. But it's all part of the learning curve. So we will get there smoothly as we move along. If you have any questions, whether you're only watching this now or you're watching the replay, please throw them in the comments. We will come back to these and look at them and include those comments and questions in the future sessions that we do as well. Joel, back to you. You know, anything else that you want to talk about on the subject this evening of, the neurodiversity and where people thrive?
Well, the challenge you set me last week of making myself a jingle, I have actually come up with that. But I'm trying to get into my mixing desk, so I'm not quite sure how to do that. So you're gonna have to teach me that as well. But I have done my jingle. In fact, for those of you who have seen who have been following RockstarX's page, you may have already heard it.
You posted it
at the beginning of the video when me and Mac went on our long road trip down to the mill in 40. You may have heard it when that happened, when at the beginning of the video, the introduction, you may have heard. I've also done another one as well, but that's beside the point. I've done two.
I think you're going to have to go and post that on RockstarX so people can go and check this jingle out. And then
I tried to download this as well last time and I couldn't do it.
Ah, okay. So in what format have you downloaded it?
I couldn't download it. That was the point. Even though YouTube, I couldn't download it through that. I couldn't download it through here. I couldn't do it.
It's okay. We'll go offline and we'll solve that technical issue and we'll make it happen. Excellent stuff. Well, Joel, as we wrap up, any final words for anybody that will be joining us on the future sessions?
We are doing a video with Jonathan Cohen on This Is Me, and we would love for you to be involved and just be yourself. Well, that's essentially what the song is telling us to be in the first place. So be yourself and film yourself being yourself. And those of you who live near, join us wherever the venue to be decided. Have fun.
Well, there you excellent stuff. When are you looking at doing this, Joel?
Jonathan needs to come back to me on that one. For his side, I'm more flexible than any of you.
It's okay. We'll have a discussion. We'll get some dates tied down, and then see where people can commit. But I have no doubt it's going to be in June. Let's make that happen. Excellent stuff. Well, folks, thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to the next six discussions. And please, you know, feel free to come and jump in and answer or ask any questions that you may have of the wonderful man that is Joel and his journey. What was the title again?
Go for it, Joel. You can remember it. Fighting for your right to party.
That's it. And that's on any level. So we're talking about whether it be at work, whether it be, behind the drums, whether it be just in life and generally, you know, every single one of us have a right to fight, to be recognized, to be accepted, and ultimately to party at our ultimate level. So Joel, I wish you all the best. And thank you so much for your time this evening. And We'll talk about your technical challenge so we can get that jingle out there very quickly. Excellent. Well, thank you very much, everybody. Go and have an incredible evening.
Yes, everyone. Go and have an incredible evening. And subscribe to Max's channel. Follow RockstarX. Follow everyone in this live, any relevant pages. If you type any of our names into the internet, whichever page it's on, follow it.
Excellent
And we'll see you in the next one.
Cheers, everybody. Thank you so much. Joel, you're becoming a natural.